All right, I hope everyone can hear me now. Okay, so I would like to talk about entanglement and characterization of entanglement in a device-dependent scenario. So, okay, the scenario is, I'm sure, familiar to everyone here. So the idea is, okay, we have some parties, say Alice and Bob, they're separated, and then they share some resource, and then in this scenario, they can produce, make some measurements on the systems to observe some outcomes. And then in this case, well, we can evaluate, or actually this situation is characterized by some joint conditional probability distribution, P of A, B given X, Y. And then in the quantum case, of course, this probability is given by the trace of the quantum state with the measurement operators, right? And this is something somehow which is true independently of the dimension of the underlying state, rho. And it's also true for actually any measurements. So in this sense, it does not rely on assumption about things, right? Even if we don't know what are the measurements, this is still valid. All right, so now the question we'd like to ask, okay, is when we have such correlations, what can we say about the underlying state? In particular, what can we say whether it is entangled or not, under which conditions? And if we know that it is entangled, actually, can we say something more and actually maybe certify the amount of entanglement present in this state? That would be basically the focus of this talk. And maybe you ask, okay, why bother about doing this in a device-dependent manner? Because, of course, there are some techniques to certify entanglement, like entanglement witnesses, or we can also do tomography of quantum state. So I guess one of the reasons for that is that most of these techniques actually typically rely on assumption about the dimension of the state or about the measurements being performed. And in this sense, they are susceptible to systematic errors. And at least in some contexts, like for instance, if we have a quantum information processor and we want to make sure that it behaves correctly, then if we want to certify entanglement in the system, well, I guess it would be useful to have a certification which does not rely on the on those assumptions, because the processor will actually work independently of whether those assumptions are correct or not, right? We'll still produce a result even if the systems are not qubits. So, all right, so let me just give an example of this sensitivity that I mentioned. So let me pick just a typical entanglement witness, which certifies entanglement for two qubit states. So this is just the overlap, by measuring the overlap with a single state. So this can be decomposed in terms of Pauli operators. So then by measuring those Pauli operators, we can evaluate this witness and then certify whether the state is entangled or not. And of course, in practice, what will happen is that so those measurements M, 1, M2, and 3, those are the ones that are supposed to be performed in the experiment. But in practice, of course, the measurements will be a little bit different by epsilon, right? So maybe N1 will be measured instead of M1, and similarly for M2 and M3. Now, if we look at the effective witness produced in this situation, so this witness here is like an entanglement witness, so it in the space of states, it really separates separable states from some other which are entangled. So violating this line certifies entanglement. However, when we have those epsilons, those little uncertainties, what happens is that the effective witness that we are testing is something slightly biased, right? And typically, it will actually also detect some separable states, right? So okay, this is, we could say, a kind of practical problem.
And moreover, this approach is not at all device independent. You have to believe that these are the measurements we make.
Yes, 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 of course, of course. But even if you believe it, you can never certify exactly, right?
So
exactly. But say even if you, okay, you still believe it and then you want still to certify, at least what you should do is, okay, estimate this epsilon and actually adapt the maybe the bound of the to do that, right? So that would be actually one way out of this if we want to make it like just the minimal effort, right? And so But this means that we have to report also systematic uncertainties, and I mean, this is also becomes cumbersome and is usually not done for obvious reasons. So one way that we could avoid this problem at all would be to find witnesses which are actually maybe insensitive to epsilons, right? And those would be actually device-independent witnesses, right? So, well, the key for doing this is, of course, to from looking, from considering the state of quantum states to looking at the state of probability distributions. So now, if we consider those objects, right? So, of course, well, you're all familiar with the local models, right? So those, we can define sets of correlations, for instance, those that are produced by local models. And those, okay, they form a convex polytope. And the facets are the so-called Bell inequalities. And we know that actually quantum theory predicts violation of those inequalities. So now, okay, we can go do the first thing that I'm sure all of you know already, is that now by testing a Bell inequality, we can certify that some correlations cannot be written in this form, right? And now, this statement certifies in particular that the underlying state here, rho, cannot be separable because a separable rho would guarantee this decomposition, right? So in this way, well, we are able, by testing a Bell inequality, to certify entanglement of the underlying state, even though we don't know its dimension, and independently of what are the measurements being performed. Okay, so this is what I say here. So okay, we can look at this as black boxes, and therefore we can look at Bell inequalities as device-dependent entanglement witnesses. Okay, so this, of course, generalizes to arbitrary number of parties. So if we test three parallel Bell inequalities, we also violation implies entanglement of the underlying state. However, when we have more than two parties, in general, I mean, some kind, there are more kinds of entanglement, and some kinds are a bit trivial. So if you think, for instance, of having three parties, of course, one way to have entanglement in a tripartite system is to have two parties share an EPR state, and then the third party being just product with them, right? And in this sense, I will say that this state, of course, is entangled, but it doesn't really exploit the multipartite aspect. So in a multipartite scenario, what we lack probably is to certify genuine entanglement. So, okay, so let's pick a tripartite system. Then, okay, we still have the definition of a local model, and this will be what it is, right? But then maybe what we want to achieve is a certification not only that the correlations are not of this form, but that they are not in a kind of hybrid form where two parties can still kind of collaborate or share entanglement, but not the third one, right? So one way to do that is to consider these hybrid local non-local models, where we just say that those probabilities can be arbitrary correlations between two parties, and they can be between any subgroups of parties. And of course, now if we can certify that some correlations are not of this form, we'll be able to certify that the state, underlying state, is not biseparable. So it will really certify genuine entanglement in this case. However, this, also known as a kind of Svetlicny decomposition, is actually not necessary to really detect genuine entanglement. And it's already sufficient. So actually, yes, this will detect genuine non-locality. But to detect the genuine entanglement, it's already sufficient to consider decomposition where each of the bipartite correlations is constrained to be quantum. Right, and we know that this is, of course, a subset. So okay, now we can consider this, and so let me give you a picture in probability space of what happens. So this is a probability space for three parties. So okay, we have the local set as before, right? So any point outside of this must come from measurement on an entangled state. But maybe the entangled state could be biseparable. So it could only maybe involve entanglement between two of the parties, right? However, this set here, the Q2 one, is the one where which is achievable with biseparable state. So this time, if you are outside of this set, we can certify really genuine entanglement. And what we see is that this set is strictly smaller than the S21 set, which is the one with the same decomposition, but where the bipartite terms can be even no signaling. So they don't need to be quantum. OK. And so now we can define this space. And this is just the set of quantum correlations, right? So now we can define hyperplanes or inequalities like this one, which are satisfied by all the correlation within this Q21 set. And then violation of this inequality will certify that the underlying state is genuinely multipartite entangled. Right? OK, so yeah, those papers give some examples of such inequalities. But now let's go to the second part of the talk that I would like to address is, okay, once that we certify that we have entanglement or genuine entanglement, how can we try to quantify it and say how much of this do we have, right? So to do this, what the approach we will try to use is to quantify entanglement monotones in terms of the violation of Abel inequality. Right, and actually this turns out to be indeed possible. So let me just give now the key idea behind this this method. So we start again from the correlations, and well, maybe some of you are familiar with this hierarchy of semi-definite programs by Navasquez, Pironio, and Asin. Right, so you know that from any correlations like this, we can construct a Moment matrix, where which contains those probabilities as entries and have some free variables. And so the approach will be to construct this matrix for these correlations, and at the same time realize that there's another way that we can obtain this matrix, which is by actually performing a CPTP map on the underlying state that we are measuring, right? And this will be actually the key. Is that this matrix, this moment matrix, can be seen both as a kind of tool to characterize those correlations, as well as actually the result of applying a map, a separable map, on the underlying state itself, right? So, and since this map is separable, it will be entanglement non-increasing, right? So therefore, we can really see this moment matrix somehow as a quantum state, as a density matrix. And once we see this, well, it's quite clear that we can just measure the entanglement on this matrix. All right? And any entanglement that we find in this matrix, since it comes from a non-entanglement increasing map, well, it must be also in the original state at first, right? So this is somehow the idea behind the method. And actually, in our case, what we will do is try to bound the negativity. So in this case, actually, we will even do, we can even work with maps which are not trace preserving, just CP maps. And that simplifies a bit the problem, but it's more of a technical advantage. So let me just give you an example of what I mean by this relation here, that those two are the same. So let's take a, let's construct an SDP matrix, a simple one, according to the NPA method. So for this, we need to choose a set of operators. So let's just choose this set of operators where A is for Alice, B for Bob, and we have here four operators. So for this set of operators, we can construct a matrix, which is this one, which contains all the products of those operators. And then basically the trick is to realize that, OK, if those are projectors, all those diagonal terms will be actually probabilities. And then the other terms here are moments, higher order moments of the measurement operators, and they are a priori unknown. But we can somehow bound them by enforcing that this is a positive matrix. Right? OK, so this is what is used in those techniques. No? And now what happens is that we can consider now a particular map, which is given by, which contains also these measurement operators. And this is a CP map. And we can check that, and it's local for Alice and Bob. And now if you apply it on the underlying state rho, whatever rho is, one can check that the result state that we obtain is actually exactly the same matrix, right? So this is somehow the trick behind this method. Okay, and now once we have this, and also realizing that negativity can be bounded in as a semi-definite program, we can put everything together and really bound the negativity from the correlations directly. And what we find is that, for instance, in the case of CHSH, now as a function of the violation of the inequality, we have a lower bound on negativity, which is just actually a straight line. So as soon as we violate the inequality, we can certify some amount of negativity, and this amount is proportional to the violation. And it reaches 1/2, which is the negativity of the single state for maximal violation. Yeah. But this method is quite general, right? So we can also apply it to different inequalities. And in particular, if we look at this I2233 or CGLMP inequality, we can now bound the negativity of the underlying state as a function of the violation. And well, we find this lower bound. Now, maybe you know that the negativity is also a quantity which is related to the dimension of the state. So meaning that if the dimension is small, then it's impossible to have a high negativity. So somehow, indirectly, with this certification, we also find some bounds on the dimension of the underlying state. So for instance here, when we have a violation of 0.25, the negativity is about 0.7. But we know that arbitrary qubits can only achieve a negativity of 0.5. So therefore, if we have this violation, we must necessarily have at least Q-treats. We also bound somehow. We find some information on the dimension in this way. And we can also apply this to multipartite systems. So for instance, in a tripartite system, we can look at the negativity as a function of the value of a Svetlicy inequality. And in particular, we can bound the genuine negativity. So the genuine negativity is a generalization of the negativity, which quantifies this time the amount of genuine entanglement. So any B-separable state has actually a genuine negativity equal to zero. And what we find again in this case is that the genuine negativity is non-zero as soon as the inequality is violated, and it increases linearly with the violation. So we find that in particular, for a maximal, we must have also a negativity of 1/2. And again, this gives us also some more information on the underlying state, because we know, some bounds are known for genuine negativity as a function of the kind of state that are measured. So for instance, we know that any state in the W class cannot achieve a negativity larger than 0.47. So this implies in particular that those states can never maximally violate this kind of inequality. So we also find, additional information about the kind of states that we're measuring in this way. Okay. So now to finish, the last point I would like to mention is about how to quantify entanglement this time in a multipartite system. Not really in terms of entanglement monotones, but more in terms to also quantify the multipartite aspect of the entangled state somehow. So as I mentioned before, the genuine entanglements certifies that somehow all the parties must be entangled with each other, right? But if we don't have genuine entanglement, maybe there's still we can still obtain a bound on how many of the parties must be entangled together, right? And this is somehow what is captured by this quantity called the entanglement depth. And so, just to give an illustration, so if we have, say, 7 parties, so if all of them are somehow related to each other, or must be related to each other in order to achieve some result, then this is exactly what we mean by saying that the state must be genuinely entangled. But if this is not the case, maybe we still can certify that at least 3 of them must be entangled together, right? So in this case, we'll say that the entanglement depth is equal to 3, right? Or if a scheme like this is sufficient to reproduce it, we'll say that the entanglement depth is equal to 4, because this is the size of the largest size of all the groups, right? So in this sense, we obtain a quantification of the multipartite aspect of the entanglement. And okay, and again now, what we would like to do is quantify this entanglement depth, and this can also be done now by SDP with a different method, and resulting in device-independent witnesses for entanglement depth. And maybe I'll give you an example of such a witness. So this inequality here is actually such a witness. So this is an inequality, a Boolean inequality which involves only n-partite correlators, En, and it has a local bound equal to 1. Right. Now what we can do is, okay, given this Bell expression, we can compute what is the violation achievable for states which, with given entanglement depth, right? And if we do that, we find that as a function of the depth k, then this violation is, the value of this expression is bounded. And remarkably, actually, this bound does not depend on the number of parties involved. It only depends on the depth of the entanglement. And so we can compute those things. And so as a function of the entanglement depth, we find different bounds like that, ranging from the square root of 2 until 3 in the limit of infinite depth. So what this means is that now if we have an experiment or we have some correlations involving, for instance, 10 parties, and we measure this and we only find somehow a value of 1.98, right? So then we can look at this and say, oh, 1.98 is larger than 1.97. So therefore, there must be at least entanglement between 6 of the 10 parties, right? Even though maybe the 10 of them are not entangled, at least 6 of them must be entangled with each other. Okay, and with this I would like to conclude. So so what I try to present is that we can certify entanglement in a way which is much more robust than standard entanglement witnesses. And in particular, we can certify also genuine entanglement without relying on genuine non-locality. And we can also quantify the negativity as well as the entanglement depth device independently. And all those bounds, of course, indirectly give also some information, some additional information on the underlying state. All right. So I'd like to thank you. For which case? I mean, device independently, the detection efficiency can be treated by just having an additional outcome, right? So then, well, you have to compute what it gives you, no? I mean, out of a specific case. I mean, of course, there will be some resistance to it, but it depends a lot on which case, no? I mean, it's not. All of those methods can be applied straightforwardly also when you have more outcomes. Now, the result that you get will depend on your precise question. But of course, there will be some resistance to that. The amount, I mean, you still need to violate a Boolean inequality in the end. So you will not be able to obtain any conclusion when you don't close the detection loophole. Apart from that. Sorry. So you say when I apply which bound?
You have a way that to lower bound the negativity.
Right? Yes.
Using violation of Bell inequality.
Yes.
So if you apply that to is there a way to see that it will vanish? Is negativity there is zero?
Yeah, it will be zero, yeah. Wait, will this certification will give zero, yes. So you mean, is there a way to see it, like, from
in your setup of how you
So you mean you want to see it analytically
yeah.
in the math? Okay, maybe I can have a look here. I don't remember asking this question this way, but yeah. Mm-hmm. But for sure, you will find nothing else. Yeah.
Last